Hi, everybody.
Hello.
Hello. Thanks for coming. Thank you. Nice crowd. Thanks. What I want to do is I'm going to slowly introduce ourselves to you and the concept or the idea behind this talk. My name is Tom Pazderka. I'm the artist. This is my show, it's my solo show. It's made up of paintings that I've been doing the past 6 months or so at the UCSB Artist Residency. I just graduated from UCSB in June of last year, and I got the third year residency fellowship. And since then, I've been basically focusing on making a whole new body of work. And most of these paintings are of the smoke clouds that were coming out of the fires that we had here last year. So I was going out there and taking pictures, and then started making these paintings. And they're made out of a mixture of oil and ashes and charcoal. Basically, the first thing that I do is I burn the panels, and then I rub them with ashes and charcoal, and I paint into them with oil that's it's watered down, and then layer by layer I make these images come out. So that's it in a nutshell. If you want to know more about these, you can come talk to me after the talk. The talk is not going to be about these. It's going to be more about artists. Precarity, the current state of things, or at least how we see it. And my guest today is Maiza Hixson, who's the curator for Santa Barbara Office of Arts and Culture. Really important person. Everybody should know who she is. And I'm actually going to let her introduce herself, because there are probably things that I would not be able to go into that she knows about herself. But one of the things that we have in common is that we both lived in the South of America for quite a bit, the Southeast. So, and every time you meet somebody in California or somewhere else that's from the South, you're kind of like, hey, we have something in common. And then when it's something, the conversation kind of goes a lot easier, I feel, because of that. We don't necessarily have shared experiences that we didn't know each other, and we just met each other. Was it December or something?
Right.
But it feels because she's from that same area that I live in, Kentucky, North Carolina. It's kind of the same. Mm-hmm. But it's also not the same, and that's the thing that I think that's what made it so interesting, is talking to you about your experiences, the places that you've been and you've seen.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, oh yeah, that's totally what I remember from that experience too. So I wanted to bring her in to talk about some of these things that affect artists, especially young artists, and Maiza's also an artist, in addition to being a curator. And I just dipped my fingers into curation not that long ago. Actually, I curated a show at the Red Barn, 12 artists, all responding to the idea of nostalgia, and what nostalgia means to them, and how nostalgia, in a way, propels society, forward or backward. And how does one place oneself in the perspective of history and society and such? Working with 12 artists, I get that this is incredibly difficult, and it takes up a lot of your time. And for the past 2 months when I was putting the show together, I literally have no time to even make my own work. So now that it's done, I'm back to making work, and it feels like I'm an artist again. So I'm just gonna turn it over to you. And I think I want the format to be pretty informal. So we're not gonna talk at you. Speeches, but I just want to have.
Where's my podium?
Yeah, where's the podium? Just want to have like a conversation. So anytime you've got questions, you can just shout it out or like raise your hand or whatever, however you want to do it. And we're just going to basically talk and have, you know, questions for each other. Ad lib. Some are written down, but you know, I'd like to kind of be, you know, serious about this. So.
All right. Well, thank you, Tom. This is an amazing exhibition, and I love how dark and brooding the work is, and how kind of apocalyptic it seems. And you know, that's a great setting for our conversation, since the NEA is being dismantled. So we can, you know, say a prayer for that. Yes, I'm a curator, and I came to curating by way of going to art school and discovering that putting together an exhibition, conceptualizing it, and installing it in a certain way could actually be a form of art. And that being said, I started to experiment with curating and started my own gallery, and realized I really didn't know the first thing about curating and all the considerations one makes in combining different elements. And that being said, I discovered that an Austrian curator was curating amazing exhibitions in Louisville, Kentucky, where my father lived. And having grown up in Cincinnati and Louisville between both my parents' homes, since they were divorced, I had a natural kind of family connection to that area of the United States. And that being said, the curator, Julian Robeson, who is the contemporary art collector at the Speed Art Museum, which is an encyclopedic museum in Louisville, was doing really interesting things and transforming the art scene there. So I wanted to get involved, and having attended the Art Institute of Chicago and learning about this master's program in Louisville, the University of Louisville, in critical and curatorial studies, I decided to enroll and got into the program, was able to get a fellowship under Julian and curate contemporary art, assisting him with various exhibitions, including bringing in scholars and artists and curators like Marcia Tucker, who's one of the, you know, most important curators who passed away, who founded the New Museum and was a, you know, very legendary feminist curator. And various other artists, Mark Wallinger, I curated a work of Gerhard Richter's at the Speed Art Museum. And so along the way, the, you know, the idea and prospect of becoming a contemporary art curator for museums started to really compel me, and I was able to curate the work of a Santa Barbara-based artist, Nathan Hayden, for my master's thesis. He later ended up attending UCSB's MFA program, moving from Louisville to Santa Barbara. So it's funny now to be here and to reconnect with him, and especially, you know, having so many ties to the UCSB, it's a really interesting full circle experience. And so I got my dream job out of my graduate program at the new beautiful building built by Zaha Hadid, the Iraqi-born architect, and who passed away recently. And this was a beautiful new building in Cincinnati. It was considered one of the most important buildings built since World War II. And it was, you know, Cincinnati was the basis of, you know, the locus for the culture wars, and the site for the Mapplethorpe controversy that you may remember. And so it was interesting, having grown up in Cincinnati, going back there as a curator, and someone who was really had always tried to escape, you know, very provincial, suburban, conservative Cincinnati, and then to be back in the heart of the downtown curating contemporary art, and trying to institute, you know, progressive themes in a contemporary art space, which was basically holding up the mantle for progressive ideas in art. I mean, you know, it was a great, great museum. And at that time, it was pre-recession, and I had a $300,000 annual curatorial budget, which, you know, at the time seemed like, I can't work under these conditions, you know, it's not enough money. And so I ended up leaving there in 2009 and moving to the East Coast, and then getting a job at the Delaware Center for the Contemporary Arts, where they said, oh, and you have a $30,000 operating budget annually. And I'm like, oh my God, it's just dwindling, just going. And you know, don't get me started on the budget I have for the Santa Barbara County Office of Arts and Culture, because it goes down from Delaware, let's put it that way. So, Yeah, and you know, along the way, getting kind of cutting my teeth on working with blue chip artists at the Contemporary Art Center in Cincinnati. I worked with Julian Stanchek. I curated a show of Daniel Leibskins, the architect who was responsible for the Denver Art Museum, Royal Ontario Museum, Contemporary Jewish Museum, the Ground Zero Memorial initially. That was very educational in terms of, you know, dealing with such a high profile architect who wouldn't come to the table without a certain dollar amount, and understanding just the politics of working with board members and selling them ideas of exhibitions, getting them to sponsor exhibitions, you know, all of that was really foundational for me and educational in terms of what people wanted to support. And the emphasis there was on bringing in artists who had a big name to, you know, put Cincinnati on the map. And you know, going back to this idea of being based in a particular geographic region that's not considered a dominant art center, that's very important to a lot of the donors and the patrons, you know, to say, hey, we can keep up with New York City, you know, we can keep up with LA. And that made sense. At the same time, though, there were so many artists making artwork in Cincinnati and in the surrounding areas that was fantastic and really responded to the iconography of the region. You know, the history of Cincinnati is being on the Underground Railroad, and it was the setting for Harriet Beecher Stowe's Uncle Tom's Cabin. And so many fascinating stories and you know, and very palpable economic and racial divisions in the city that, you know, artists were responding to that I felt was being eclipsed by just kind of importing these famous artists. And so that really was the impetus for me to start developing this understanding of critical regionalism, of how artists in a particular geographic region could have a voice that was sophisticated, that responded to themes in, you know, international contemporary art discourse, and was worthy of museum recognition. And so before I left Cincinnati, I came up with this idea of a show called Young Country on rural themes in art. Really sexy. So I had to try to sell that one, and you know, that was about the time of the recession, and I felt like it was honestly an important statement about how the kind of coastal elitism that happens, the, you know, hierarchical nature of the art world, how, you know, economically stratified the United States is. All those themes were part of this exhibition, Young Country, and I was interested in how individuals from disparate places everywhere, from the rural South to Cincinnati to Indianapolis to you know, people living just outside of these dominant centers, were able to make very interesting statements. I mean, there was an artist who was living in Virginia named Suntek Chung, who was from Korea, but he also was based in the South. And so people would say, you know, where are you from, you know, in the South? And he would be like, you know, South Korea. And he made artwork about this whole idea of his relationship to the world. So he would create these narrative tableaus of himself as like a kind of, you know, country rube sitting on in a log cabin. And, you know, he would have like the Korean flag in the background, and it would look like a Confederate flag, but he would splice the symbols, and so he would make commentary about that. And he had a belt buckle that he made that said, like, the South Korea will rise again. Yes. And he just played with those themes, and I thought it was interesting. So I curated this, I couldn't pull it off at the Contemporary Art Center, and I ended up having to put it on the back burner because I left the museum because I could never advance there, honestly. With my background, I needed to go to New York in order to expose myself to this art world that, you know, was really much, it was informing the decisions that the curators and the directors of the Contemporary were making. And so, I mean, I had moved to New York in 2000, but, and I had lived in various cities, you know, across the United States, but it was still really important to gain that experience. So I moved to Philadelphia. Worked at the Fabric Workshop and Museum, was there for about a year before becoming the director of the DCCA, Delaware Center for Contemporary Arts. And I guess what I want to say to, you know, sum it up is that it's really important that we be mindful of the artwork being made in our own backyard. And I don't curate on the basis of trying to select artists by name recognition or opening the pages of Art Forum and saying, oh, this person's huge, you know, we gotta get them in here. And that's why I really wanna cultivate, wherever I go, the community of artists, because they are the ones who are making very important work about what it means to be from a particular place. And that is an important thing to register, I think, in the history of art. So. Oh,
great.
Yeah.
There was a number of times I wanted to jump in there and really just start asking these questions where, okay, so you're, you know, as a curator, right, so you work with artists, but you also work with money, right? So then how does the artist and the money, how does that get
where
married?
Is right?
Yeah. Because
it's a direct question.
And I know this is it's a pretty direct question, but like, in terms of you get a budget, right? But where does the money go, and where does the artist stand in relationship to everything else? Because, you know, as an artist myself, you know, it's constantly you know, there's this constant push towards, well, like, if I want to keep making work, like, you know, in that like cliche, like in this economy, right? If I want to make work, and if I want to make a living, you know, the money's going to come from somewhere. You know, it's from, you know, is it from selling work? Is it from something else? Is it from grants? You know, the grants don't amount to too much, and so many times the grants, you can't really use them for your living expenses. You can only use them for putting on exhibitions or, you know, making artwork. So there are limits put on all these things that. That come your way.
Right.
So I find that more and more artists are being steered into areas that aren't related to art at all. You know, where like you gotta do something else in order to support your art practice.
Absolutely.
And then you end up sometimes in places that offers money.
Mm-hmm.
But even that kind of you know, that kind of cash flow is hard
right.
to come by because it's
right.
extremely competitive. Now, this thing came through where the University of Berkeley is putting out a statement about, you know, Donald Trump proposing a budget cut to all the major federal cultural agencies, you know, from the National Endowment of the Arts to the Endowment of Humanities, Institute of Museum Library Services, and so on and so on. All these things that are potential sources of money for artists, right? So then, back to my original question, like, so you work with artists, like, what is it that you see where you can, like, do for them or do with them? How does an institution even help an artist put on a show or make work of art?
Right. Well, let me answer one of those questions first. You know, I wasn't born with a silver spoon in my mouth, and it's been very difficult to make my way in the world as a curator and as an artist. I realized that at some point I had to create an opportunity for myself to be around artists and to be able to survive. And so that was definitely one reason I went into curating. It places you at the center of dialogue. And, you know, you want to surround yourself with artists, obviously, and interface with them. So I felt it was a great opportunity for me to take advantage of that and, you know, to elevate my own kind of create visibility for myself in that regard without taking advantage of any position as a curator, because when you're curating for institutions, you certainly would never curate your own work. And so I've always kept those two worlds separate. I see that a lot in the art world, where people, you know, curators will put themselves in exhibitions, and when you're dealing with money for art exhibitions in an institutional setting, it's a definite conflict of interest. And so, that being said, I started to develop my own kind of understanding of what curating could be, and all of that is to say that I feel like I've been able to exercise creativity and be an artist in a professional role without showing my artwork per se. And that, what I mean to say by that is that I experiment with the medium of curating as an artistic one. And when I was at the Delaware Center, I wrote a grant to receive basically funds from Andy Warhol Foundation, which is a fabulous foundation that is very forward-thinking and grants amazing awards of all kinds, curatorial research and art awards for exhibitions. And you know, and that was for a series of four interactive exhibitions called Radical Participation. And I was really interested in creating relevance for the institution that had largely ignored the immediate population of the, you know, African-American urban sector in downtown Wilmington. Essentially, it was, you know, very segregated culture where the board of the DCCA was, you know, landed gentry, white elites who would basically, you know, support the institution, but who didn't understand the immediate population or didn't try to create inroads for the immediate population to actually create relevance for the museum in the city. And so I wanted to basically use the exhibition as a medium to engage a dialogue and to encourage people to kind of talk about what an ideal city would look like and what that would mean in terms of an exhibition. So I created a utopia as an exhibition, and I asked people to come in, all walks of life, anybody, young, old, gay, straight, married, unmarried, you know, racially diverse backgrounds, to come and inform the nature and future of this city as an exhibition. And so with that being said, I won't go on and on about this exhibition, but it was pretty much a vehicle to engage people in a dialogue that hadn't been had, where the museum was placed at the center of an important community discourse about what exhibitions could be, what art should be, how it should be more relevant to the city, and that it didn't have to just be artwork on a wall. And so that is socially engaged artistic practice. That's one example of it, and that's how I've survived as a curator and artist in the art world, by functioning in a kind of professional role, but infusing that role with as much creativity as possible to, you know, interrogate the possibility of the exhibition itself. Still, you know, helping artists, still giving them opportunity. I mean, I got $75,000 from the Warhol Foundation to implement these exhibitions, and was able to provide honoraria for artists who came forward with ideas for what an ideal city would look like. So we had one artist from Texas who created a design charrette inside of the exhibition space that would be for a public art in an empty lot. And his name's Eric Lashinsky. And so he was funded for implementing that project, which ended up becoming an actual park. So some of the ideas that were created within the context of that exhibition ultimately became real life projects. And so with that being said, you know, that's one way an artist can perform and remain committed to his or her practice. It may not be, you know, the kind of notion of romantic notion of having, you know, an art exhibition in a white cube space, but in a way for me it was something that was very inclusive and meaningful. But so to answer your question, with, you know, with regard to all the other questions pertaining to financial backing for artists, it's different. You know, I mean, working for a museum, theoretically you have an operating budget, and the curator decides, okay, I'm going to curate an exhibition, and these are the amounts that I want to pay artists. I'm going to extend an invitation. They get paid some honorarium. They're commissioned to do something. You don't pay an artist to do an exhibition unless you commission them to do new work. So that's, you know, certainly part of it. And I'm seeing a hand. Yes, Bay.
I can wait.
No, go ahead. That's the format.
Yeah. I'm just curious, Maiza, and actually Tom too, if you've been influenced by Maiza, say a curator like Lucy McLaren with the local, and, you know, became very intrigued with this idea of the richness of the region that she found herself. thing. And then an artist like, and I don't even know how to pronounce his first name, but Feaster Gates.
Feaster Gates. Absolutely.
And he's an interesting person to look at because the way that he supports his art practice is slightly different than what you know, kind of like run-of-the-mill artist does. I mean, as far as
this
I know,
this is an artist who's based in the South Side of Chicago.
Yeah.
And he is a socially engaged artist, and his artwork is all about kind of involving publics and using art to transform an impoverished community and build it back up. I just want to set the stage before you went on.
And that's the thing. As much as I know about him, which is not a whole lot. I mean, like I know a little bit, but I think that his method is by raising money through sales of art is to basically then funnel it back into the community by rehabilitating buildings around Chicago and then turning them into basically places that people can go and gather. But then I also think he's got his hands in real estate as well. So it's he does a lot of as an artist, you know, he's got his assistants doing some work on his work while he goes to meetings of various boards and proposes projects.
But he also finds things on the street that he then turns into art, which is something that you kind of do.
Right? And I can talk about that. And you know, in one way to make it, at least for me, would be to keep my overhead as low as possible.
Right.
Not spending lots of money on expensive materials and products and things like that, but rather to focus on things that are already there, that are available, that I can just go and pick up. A lot of my materials come from donations. People have given me stuff over the years. When I used to paint houses, I was a house painter and carpenter. You know, I would be on these jobs, and frequently the owners or clients would say, "Hey, I have 10 cans of paint. You know, can you use it?" I'm like, "Yeah, I can totally use it."
Yeah.
So I would take it. You know, somebody else would ask, "You know, hey, I have all this pile of stuff in the back. Can you do something with this?" They're like, "Yeah, sure, I can totally do that. I would make furniture out of it. I would make artwork out of it." So really, the thing is, there's no set equation for this, but knowing that I can make artwork that I know I can maybe sometime down the road sell for X amount of money, knowing that I only put this amount, that's okay. I think most of my overhead comes from keeping a studio. But if you find a studio that's rent-free, that's even better. I mean, one of the things that I'm doing now is basically looking for places like residencies. So residencies, especially the ones that you don't have to pay for or that give you a stipend, those are great because they give you a space. B, they give you exposure. You just have to figure out how to get there, especially if they're out of state or Europe or wherever. But they're really great at keeping your overhead down to a minimum. Because after a while, you end up with bills that just end up piling up and piling up.
I wanted to go back to one thing you said. Yes.
I just want to say hi.
Hi.
I don't know why you're doing that.
Woo!
Oh,
thank you. I wanted to meet you, but I have a house guest. I didn't think I was going to get to be here today at all, but my house guests were running late and just texted me to be there 15 minutes.
Love your style, man. Yeah.
Thank you.
So I'll
see you next
later.
Week, actually, because, yeah.
Okay. Nice to meet you. Thanks for coming. Sorry.
Bye. So sad, Barbara. I was going to say, you said, you mentioned the term visibility or exposure.
Right.
And I wanted to go back to that in the context of discussing, what artists are getting in exchange for the work they do. And there's this organization called Wage. Has anybody heard of it besides the famous curators in the audience? Please. It's called Working Artists and the Greater Economy, and it's a New York-based activist organization focused on regulating payment of artist fees by nonprofit art institutions. And basically, it's really about getting artists paid for the kinds of contributions they make. And for example, you know, working in the nonprofit sector, I've seen this so many times over where the preparator, the person who is installing the artwork, is the least paid on the staff. And they do so much hard work to make the space look great. Or even, you know, independent curators who are contracted to do an exhibition for a museum might not get paid what they're worth. And so this organization was founded to try to create a collective action among artists and art workers to prevent that from happening. So this is a movement. This is a, you know, they have what they call a womanifesto on their website. And but it's really for, you know, independent curators, visual and performing artists, to basically kind of protect against this bias that the folks who actually are where the rubber meets the road, who make exhibitions happen, are not as valuable in terms of what they bring to the institution. I mean, typically you have the director and the development director, people who are raising the funds, who are the highest paid. And in many cases and instances in my career, I've seen people who are, you know, starving artists who are like the preparators and installers and crew members, art handlers, who are trying to make it as artists, and they are the least compensated for their work. And I've always felt like, why in so many different fields are there unions, but not in the museum world? Mm-hmm. And the reason is because it's so competitive that they're afraid to rise up. They're afraid because they think they'll get blacklisted, and they probably will. And so, I mean, in my experience, that's just been a very interesting study in class within a hierarchical institution like a museum. And, you know, the same can be said for, you know, working for the government. As a public art curator, I'm finding, you know, more and more that there's such a fundamental lack of understanding of the arts, the very highest levels, that it's very difficult to even make a case for why art matters, and let alone have a more nuanced discussion of what is public art, what is, you know, the nature and relationship to art, and how can we advance discourse about it. You know, right now I struggle with being able to fund artists. The budget is totally scarce. The county's in a $30 million deficit, and while the county does receive percent for art funds, those are all pertaining to capital building projects in the county, and that money is capped at $75,000 per project. So when you're talking about getting money into pockets of artists immediately, it's just absolutely almost impossible. So, you know, the Office of Arts and Culture, we've been trying to figure out and identify grants and organizations that we can go to who will fund us. So we just wrote a grant for the Santa Barbara Beautiful, and they funded us to implement a public art project at the Jardín de las Granadas, and we were able to bring in two artists who do light-based projections, who I worked with for Lightworks Isla Vista, Kim Cochran and Jonathan Smith, to address that space, and that's a commissioned work. So, you know, and that was something where we got some matching funds, and we did some in-kind bargaining, and we got about $10,000 for that project. But how can you live off that as an artist, like those piecemeal projects? And so artists are house painters, artists are, you know, then you talk about artists who go and get their MFAs and they become academics and professors. And then they're literally...
Which again, those are really competitive.
Those are extremely competitive. Yeah. And like, so I guess we should maybe turn to this idea of the precariat, and that's a buzzword. And, you know, Tom and I wanted to kind of discuss what that definition really means. And very quickly, it is this sort of buzzword that's been going around, and it's basically this idea of the tenuous nature of employment in the art world, as we're describing the term, but it really applies to the sense of instability, and that anything can kind of topple you if you're an art worker in this field. If you, you know, run into an unforeseen circumstance where you have, you know, an emergency or something like that could really just ruin your life. And so you're constantly trying to figure out how to keep it all together and balance all of these different, you know, makeshift positions of making money.
I think it's really interesting that this term, I mean, we're talking specifically about art workers, but the term precarious is actually applied to all sorts of workers now,
right,
that are living in precarity. They are living in a completely unstable environment where they don't know where the next paycheck is coming from. Because the paychecks are now not coming from an employer, but they're coming from, you know, let's say clients or just people that they pick up, you know, just on the side, you know, while they're looking for work, basically. So. And this is why I thought it was going to be an interesting topic for you, because I think artists, in some sense, while it's not a really great situation to be in, they have in some ways figured out how to do it. I mean, like, I've always kind of figured out how to supply money into my art practice. You know, like, not in a great way sometimes, but, you know, there's always something coming in, and I just fall back into the art practice. The question is, you know, how does somebody else do that, you know? And, like, knowing individuals, other individuals' methods of doing that, I think is really telling.
Mm-hmm.
What the precariat actually means nowadays is that it's something that is, if everyone's familiar with the term proletariat, right? Like, you know, 20th century term applies to somebody that basically works for a living, but works not on their own. They don't own their means of production, or any of that. They don't even see the product that comes out at the end, right? Well, the precariat is a 21st century term, and why it's a buzzword is because it did gain traction within the past 5 to 10 years or something like that, as the precariat being something that's actually below the proletariat. So if you imagine, you know, if you were part of the proletariat, you were already at the bottom, and now there's a subsection.
The precarious
proletariat. The precariat doesn't even have the security of the proletariat, which actually had, you know, they had to work for a living, but actually they had the job. So, I mean, you know, they didn't, you know, they probably didn't get fired because they actually had a union behind them. The precarity of
developed after the under the neoliberal post-Fordist capitalist reality.
Right. That too. There's always a caveat to all these things. And I think that with the precariat, what's really interesting is that it gets a bad rap, one, because, you know, it's really difficult to imagine, you know, how you're gonna get out of the situation.
She got out of the situation.
Yeah. isn't the proletariat a term that comes out of communism, the state-controlled worker, where it's not, let's say, a union person who would be working here. I think it's directly related to a system, a political system,
mm-hmm.
where the worker works for the state, essentially, whereas the precariat is not. I can see where it comes from, that terminology, but it really goes in a different direction. It's not connected to a state-run kind of situation. But I see the parallels.
Oh, yeah.
I believe it had developed into that, even though, you know, as Marx pointed out already in the 19th century when he was describing what was happening under under capitalism, was that there was a subset of the working class that didn't actually have bargaining rights. They were the ones that were on the, you know, they were the ones building all the machines and making all the products. But you would have not necessarily, you know, heard of them or seen them. And they weren't thought of as a group until somebody gave them that name. You know? So the idea that there is a precariat is somebody named them. I mean, but this subset of, or this group of people, you know, they've been there, and really the precariat is I think it's marked by the whole idea of working short term and based on contracts, as opposed to you know, constant work. So that
basically any kind of governmental assistance, as far as health insurance, the dismantling of all of those government subsidies, basically has created the situation of like with adjunct professorships, mm-hmm. where you have to piecemeal all this work together just to create a living wage. And then what that means is that there is no actual time to make the artwork, to make the create a product. So it's a catch-22. Yeah.
It is.
Yes.
I guess my question goes in a different direction, but I'm curious both of your thoughts as to the place that we live in and what is particular to Santa Barbara. I've been thinking about the art world here and even the group of people sitting here, our connections, variety as artists, some professionals, some not, curators, whatever we may be, and what makes us different. What are our particular challenges or opportunities here that you see within that bigger picture of, all the challenges? And I was curious I was waiting for you to say, and here's why I came to Santa Barbara. I'm thinking.
For a job.
There you go. But I guess that's my question specific to our place. And all the different players, parties in the art world here. And how does that all sort of fit together? How do you see it? Or Central Coast,
Mm-hmm. How many hours do you
have? A few.
I'm gonna start with this one. I know you wanna jump in. And this is something you already started talking about. As artists, we don't necessarily, doesn't seem like I'm allowed to speak for artists, I don't know why. I don't really want to. But the thing is that as artists, we don't tend to identify as a group, I don't think.
And that's the problem.
I'm starting to become more personally interested in artists as a group, not as necessarily individuals. Because I know for a fact, and maybe I'm missing something, but there have not been any studies done, or like longitudinal studies even, of artists as a group. I mean, like, we have studies of like the homeless, and we have studies of, blah, 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 but we don't have studies of artists as basically a group of people that make a specific kind of contribution, but we literally know very little about them. And one of the things is that artists are tough to pin down. They're tough to get back to or with them. And also there's this non-identification that comes along with it. That as soon as you start, like this is why I said I don't want to be speaking for somebody, because as soon as you start doing that, somebody's gonna raise their hand like, well, that's not me. I'm not doing that. I don't want to have to be lumped in with your specific way of looking at things.
Well, that goes back to this idea of the precariat, because it's based upon the idea that Foucault talks about this, that the artist's search for autonomy and self-determination, these ideals are the things that are used to promote the conditions required by the capitalist system. So, the more we want to self-express and kind of be considered individuals, politically, it can be untenable for any kind of solidarity. And how can artists, that's why I mentioned wage, because that's another way in which artists are actually trying to form collectives to protect each other and leverage that against the system that totally wants to divide and conquer.
Right.
Bae?
I don't know, I just have to be a little bit of a devil's advocate. It just seems
right
to me that art history is just littered with examples of artists coming together as groups to make things happen. I mean, look at the Bauhaus. Look at, there are just so many examples. Look at Black Mountain College. Look at Bennington College. Oh, the Wild Rider. I mean, you know, you just.
It's not to say that they it's basically that with this age, this contemporary era of the kind of competition required to compete in a global art market.
Yeah.
When you're talking about, you know, the level of Jeff Koons and Damien Hirst and all of these artists who are essentially their own empire. It's so difficult for an individual artist to make it in that landscape. And not only that, but the nature of, I think, what artists want to do is figure out a vehicle for, you know, new forms of collective consciousness and emancipation. I mean, you know, artists are not here to decorate, and I think that a lot of artists have seen the landscape of the commercialization and the corporatization of the art world, and they've rejected it outright, and they don't want to be a part of the system, and at the same time, they've got to survive in that system. So, in many cases, artists are doing what I was sort of describing, which is socially engaged artistic practice, which is non-object based. Because, you know, that whole idea of trying to make an object to put into some sort of circulation, it automatically kind of curtails your ability to be radical. And so with that being said, I think that some of the most radical artwork is being made now by collectives. I mean, when I look around Santa Barbara to answer your question, you know, one of the most interesting collaborations and nonprofits to me is Fishbone. Fishbone is a 501c3, and it's an artist collective. They've got a warehouse off of Quarantina, and they work really hard to produce, you know, DIY theatrical productions. They host events and are basically doing things that I think are pushing the envelope for Santa Barbara. And that's the kind of example I would say. I'd say Santa Barbara Center for Art, Science, and Technology, the newly developed artist live work housing space that provides subsidized housing for artists, is an incubator and is going to give birth to a new generation of artists in Santa Barbara. And I think those are really exciting, you know, developments, but we need more. We need much more. And the lack of affordable housing, you know, the lack of warehouse space for artists is kind of disturbing. It's prohibitive to me, make an art career as an individual artist in this city. I don't see how any artist does it. I have no idea. I mean, I can tell you how they paint houses and they work outside of the county. They try to develop their career outside of Santa Barbara because, for whatever reason, there aren't enough collectors here to support the community of artists.
I think there are enough collectors. They're just not collecting here.
Yeah. They're not collecting here. I think there's kind of a standstill with regard to the dialogue of what contemporary artistic practice can be.
Yeah.
You know, there's a whole lot of landscape painting. There's a whole lot of just kind of de facto definitions of art, and that's something I keep coming up against as a curator, trying to advance more dialogue. And this is why I appreciate the opportunity to speak today, to be with you today, because it's like I'm not tasked with that, to re-envision or, you know, make a call for radical new ideas in art. We have a traditional sort of, I think, situation, paradigm in the city where we have galleries. Galleries are where you show art. It's two-dimensional or three-dimensional, and it takes the form of this, and we hope it's saleable. And that is happening against the backdrop of tourism, which, of course, is the most important thing since this is a resort town. And we need to, you know, continue to get those dollars in. And it's, you know, from my experience working on events and festivals, grant committees, people say, we got to put heads in beds, heads in beds. And that seems to be what it's about. So if an artist can make some artwork that can put some heads in beds, well, they're going to make it.
Mm-hmm. Why not make beds?
Exactly. Why not make really interesting radical bets? I'm gonna write that down.
I do want to go back to what you said though about like Black Women College and the Bauhaus and all that. If you look at them as a group, yeah, sure. There's a time and a place. You know, one's called the Bauhaus and the Black Women College, but actually, like, there was internal strife all throughout. When people were like butting heads, and actually the reason that those institutions didn't last as long is because there was way too much difference. I mean, there were things happening in Black Mountain College about, you know, their identity. You know, are we collectivists? Are we communists? You know, are we anti-segregationists and all this? This was also happening in places that were politically being affected by, let's say, like in the South by, you know, Jim Crow laws, and then, you know, Bauhaus was running up against Nazi Germany. So you know, those specific groups, they weren't as powerful at the time as we now give them credit for,
yeah.
I think. And that's part of the romanticization of the past, I think, too. And I think one of the things that, or the problem for artists that, you know, that made, let's say, like, want to come together is that, like, artists aren't ones to, like, butt heads with somebody else. You know, if anything, it's more like, well, I'm just going to go and make artwork about it. You know, I'm going to write a poem or something like that. And, you know, release it out into the world, into the ether, and see if it takes. As opposed to, like, come together and have a collective voice about something that that maybe ought to be talked about. But again, like, how do you get a bunch of individuals together to talk about something that affects all of them? I mean, for example, and this isn't just about artists. If you look at the living wage as it is now, the last time that that the minimum wage was raised was, like, you know, in the 90s or like in the early 2000s, right? It's at like $7.50 now. If you project it through inflation to today, the minimum wage should be more like $22 an hour. Actually, it should be much higher than that. It should be probably more like $30 or $40. Just because as a single person living today, you know, you would have, how much do you have to work with, you know, the living wage, or with the wage that you get in order to survive, right? So that's, and what's really interesting is that, okay, one of the things about the living wage is that, again, like, it goes back to, it goes back in time, you know, like, when, nobody would want to have a wage that's basically at the level of, like, the 1960s, which is, like, where basically when people were able to make a living wage at that moment. And since then, it's been kind of a slide downward, you know, where basically prices were going like this, but wages were stagnating. And we get these little bumps along the road, but that's kind of it.
There's something like energy seems to happen in certain places. Like, I moved here from Philadelphia in 2008, and everyone in Philadelphia in the arts scene, they're talking about this book called The Creative Class, by Richard Florida.
Right.
Yeah.
And I remember it just seemed like a lot of young people interested in some art form or other were moving to Philadelphia. As opposed to New York, because there was space, they could afford it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you know, really interesting things were starting to happen, like all over the state. It was really kind of amazing. That's not going to happen in San Diego because we don't have that kind of real estate. Maybe it's, I don't know what's really happening in LA. LA's kind of, you know, the
because right now it's the kind of gold rush and
But isn't it interesting how that, you know, there is something very attractive about people who are making things that are interesting. And that energy attracts money and it attracts other people and it makes things happen. And then the irony is that other people often make money off of it.
That's what I was going to point out. There's always a caveat. I think that with Florida's book, it normalizes something that's actually a problem. So he calls it the creative class, but you can actually call it the precarity because it's one and the same thing.
Well, and then it paves the way for gentrification.
Right.
You know, artists are basically advertising for developers to come in and take over the warehouses that they create.
I think one of the things is that artists have a tough time, or a lot of artists have a tough time asking for money. We're asking for that living wage. That's, you know, how do you do that? Because that means that your work, you have to sort of tell yourself that you're worth the money that you're asking for, right? So how do you do that? There are basically students getting out of a 4-year college right now that are getting into tech that know their worth because it's set by the market. And it's something like, you know, I don't know what it is, like 150 an hour? I don't know, it's something like that. You know, even if it's 50 an hour, you know you're gonna get out there into the tech world and know you're gonna make a minimum of this amount because that's the line of work that you've chosen. There's nothing like that for artists. We don't talk about that. Like, you don't have this kind of a, yes, I'm getting to you. Basically,
well, you don't have this kind of focus on practical logistical skills that in an MFA program. I mean, it would be illuminating if they actually taught, you know, planning a budget for artists in an MFA program, but it's considered déclassé, and you know, we need to get over that. And it's like, you know, I mean, in many ways, the MFA is kind of like the new MBA on some level, as you know, you have to kind of create your particular artwork, figure out how to talk about it in a way that's new and different, and that sells the concept to a particular collector. So we do gain skills, and we are actually trained in a kind of business savvy way, but then you get out of school, and people in the business world look at you and say, artist, you don't have any skills, which is a complete infantilization of artists and their potential. They are natural, born business people. They know how to create create a product, and which is what business, you know, entrepreneurs do. You seem like you wanted to make sense.
I think part of the problem is the whole MFA system itself. If you go back to some history, let's just go back to the United States in the 40s, for example. During the war and after the war, there were New York. I come from New York, so I know about it. There were not that many galleries. There were really, you could probably put them on two hands. The Julian Levy, Pierre Matisse, Peggy Guggenheim. I mean, there were not that many. And artists, they knew each other. They all, I wouldn't say cooperated, but they knew each other. Mm-hmm. They got together. They would talk about their work. And then somewhere, I don't know whether it was the GI Bill or what, but I don't know when the MFA programs really started to kick in. Oh, and also, collectors would actually go to artist studios. They would discover there's something that's missing these days from collectors. I mean, in some ways I feel sorry for them. Now they go to art fairs and they see work that's already been chosen. They're not making a creative distinction themselves. They're not given the opportunity to make their mind up whose work really resonates without somebody as an intermediary coming in between. And so when MFA programs developed, then this whole corporate system came along with it. And so it just has blossomed into this thing that's gargantuan, and it's very difficult for artists to break through unless you're one of the art stars. And if you're an art star, that has its own problems, because then you have to keep producing what you've been producing in variations on a theme. Whereas if you're an independent artist, you can go anywhere you want to in terms of your work. But I do think that part of the problem is the glut of people who are coming out of MFA programs, not all of whom are necessarily going to live a life of a practicing artist, which is a very difficult life to lead for any of you here who have done that. So,
well, it's totally irresponsible for universities to generate that many and to not take responsibility.
Right,
for the fact
and to really fair
that
them out.
Their students won't ever be placed in jobs,
and right.
Especially if the art institution, the you know, school is producing so many, you know, philosophers and not people who can, you know, market a skill set, so to speak. Like, you know, there are amazing artists whose artworks are based on walks and based on things that, you know, are kind of living as an art, an aesthetic form, living. And how are they supposed to make a living? You know, to my mind, MFA programs should not ever charge an art student tuition. It should be totally funded, and students shouldn't be suckered into going unless they are fully funded.
I don't know if I agree with that, but I do agree with training, financial training within the system itself,
including
the MFA programs. But I didn't go through an MFA program. They weren't around when I was, I did a PhD in art history instead. But I just think that this turnout, and you know, and then you get supplanted very quickly by the number of other people coming up, and they're very interesting, but do they hang on? Do they have a long span? Is there an arc to their career? And I feel sorry for these. I feel sorry for all of us, frankly. And then we're expected to give our work away.
Did anybody see that movie Untitled, about the sound artist who's trying to make a go of it in New York? And it's really funny, and it's a hilarious send-up of the art world, just in terms of its pretension and conceits. You know, he makes sounds out of like really weird things, like he finds his gallerist's dress that's made of patent leather, like fascinating, so he asks if he can record it, and that's how they begin the relationship. And there's a guy who's selling traditional paintings hand over fist, and he gets front gallery listing. And but it's basically that whole idea of how can you make radical art if the only way you can sell or make a living is by fulfilling a stereotype of what art is that's existing, that's not pushing the boundaries. That's my question.
Well, I think you can.
What's the compelling artistic work being made today that, you know, makes us reorient and reframe our thinking about what art is in general? That's to me what the role of art is. And so I think that it's really difficult when you try to sell.
I'm not sure that it's necessary to rethink the role of art. I think the difference is to rethink the role of art in a particular time and place. But, you know, art, no matter what, you could say, you could go back to Egypt and there's a function of art in that particular place, or Europe in the 19th century, in France, or here in Santa Barbara, addressing your question about Santa Barbara.
I think it's important to always re-theorize art, to constantly be in dialogue with what it is.
I think one of the things, too, would be, re-theorize the whole idea of art being a luxury. You know, that it's something that's basically there to make your house look pretty.
You could say
as opposed to make you think about
art is either worthless or priceless.
Right.
In our society.
And again, I think that
an art is a luxury that artists pay for.
That's right.
Right.
Yeah. Someone famous said that.
And I do have to double back on this whole idea that, you know, and part of it, I do blame the artists for this too, because, you know, I find that in myself sometimes as well. It's like, if you don't have the confidence to say that I am worth this much, then, you know, the person that you're talking to or that you're trying to present yourself to is not going to take you seriously. And, you know, the MFAs and the BFAs, they do not instill that. So many don't even teach actual skills as much as theory anymore.
Well, but that is a skill, and I mean, I think it's just it's unquantifiable, and this is an anti-intellectual environment in the United States, and so there isn't a whole lot of reward for thinking, period, let alone theorizing art. But I also wanted to go back to, because this is a sprawling conversation, the whole idea of what post-studio practice means today. Like, you know, we're kind of combating a tradition of people sequestering themselves in the studio, and I think that contemporary understanding of art is that we're trying to get people out of their studio and into the world, and, you know, not being that traditionally hermetically sealed, you know, starving, disgruntled, depressive artist. And so a lot of artists are fighting that stereotype by making artwork that is about social engagement, that's about, you know, community organizing and more public activist strategies, and kind of reinvigorating what it means to be a public artist, a public intellectual. And to a certain extent, I think that the MFA program, if it's a more, you know, conceptual school, does kind of institute the importance of thinking, writing, conversing. Like, the role of the studio critique is, I think, invaluable for artists now, because they're forced into a community of, you know, peers. And that dialogue is something that really translates to any, I think, profession. So many artists are going into the corporate world and finding value for themselves in the corporate sphere. I attended an art conference the other day, an art educators conference, and it was about design thinking strategies in corporate settings, and that most people don't even know what it means to be creative. And this artist who had studied how to paint, and wanted to be Picasso growing up, was able to parlay his MFA into essentially, art, design, motivational speaking for Google. And, Google sent their top executives to him for 3 days so that he could talk to them about really the most basic ways in which artists think and approach problems every day that, your tech engineer may not adopt or, may need to relearn eventually. So, that's something that the Daniel Nevers, who is at the Center for Cultural Innovation, talked about, is how do artists kind of occupy the corporate sphere and do it creatively and get paid what they're worth. And that, of course, does not resonate with many artists who don't want to go into that corporate atmosphere. But, that world needs artists, and that's how we also create demand for ourselves. So I think, I showed Joe Girondola's duct tape paintings at Channing Peak Gallery, and the funny thing is that he sponsored $50,000 in kind donation of duct tape by the company SureTech. And so that being said, he's been able to use that medium, and he's led courses at the University of Cincinnati and the University of the Arts in Philadelphia, and he teaches with the duct tape that's given. And the students learn how to build and make, and in turn, the artist just keeps getting sponsored, and he's created a duct tape fair in the middle of Avon, Ohio. Now granted, this is not what we all aspire to as artists, I'm not saying that, but there are ways in which you can, enter into those spheres and try to get some funding, try to get some material support.
Another thing is that we're living at a time where there's a paradigm shift for everything. And the paradigm shift here is digital technology in terms of the creative process. What we're doing, those of us who are continuing to paint or to make objects by hand, may find that in, I don't know how many years, that this will still exist, but certainly not to the same level, because we're really moving very quickly into another age, and that age will provide the materials for artists to really expand into the social world in a far more effective way, I believe, than we're able to now. Because they will be getting the training. I would hope that MFA programs eventually, if they're not doing it now, are teaching really very sophisticated digital
Definitely.
Skills.
They are, yeah. You've got the media art and technology program that used to be.
And that's going to change everything. And that enters into the corporate
world in a way.
It has changed.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which actually was
It's changed the collecting policies of museums. Mm-hmm. The Walker Art Center, collects net-based art and has for years. And then, they talk about conserving online artwork and how does that happen? Mm-hmm. And it's a whole different ball of wax. Yeah.
That was actually something that I was going to bring up too. Was how does the online change the landscape of art in real terms? You think about galleries shutting their doors, and things like, if you just walk around Santa Barbara, retail is going down like this,
yeah,
because of Amazon and,
right,
and so on. With art, increasingly so much art is being made really just on the internet, and it's being seen by the thousands, but who is actually, who's collecting it, who's, where does it end up? If you do any kind of Instagram or anything like that, one of the problems that I have with it is that Instagram tends to flattens everything out and makes everything, this size, right? Yeah, it's a little tiny square. You really have no idea how big something is from that, unless there's a person sitting right in front of something. But, So is it change? Is it for the better or for the worse, or is it just kind of neutral? You know, it's really hard to gauge now because, okay, before Instagram there was something else. Like, I know people were selling work through Facebook. Now really art's not being sold through Facebook all that much. Saatchi Art is selling some, they're selling a lot of work, but most of it is, you know, two-dimensional. Two-dimensional paintings that go into someone's house. I've sold work through them, for example. But the longevity of some of these, you know, it's hard to gauge how long Instagram is going to be around. I mean, everybody thought that MySpace was going to be around forever, and, you know, they went like this and like this. You know, they got overtaken by Facebook. Facebook might go like this in just a little while. Instagram might go like this until something else.
But the digital technology is always there.
But that's going to be
the platform may change.
Yeah, but you're stuck in this cycle where you're constantly you have to enter new platforms and learn how they operate, right? So
it's just a tool.
So exactly. So you're navigating the world of galleries and museums and art centers, but at the same time you're navigating the world of Instagram and you know, followers and likes and things like that.
I've just noticed, you know, some really amazing memes throughout the whole political season. Like, you know, the hilarious memes that are on Facebook, and I've seen calls for entries for artists to apply with their memes. And, you know, so with that being said, museums as well are utilizing applications like Snapchat. I read about, I think it was the Walker that was advertising the opportunity to purchase Alex Soth's photographs that would appear on Snapchat and then disappear. That's the way that Snapchat works. You know, an image appears and then disappears. And I thought it was a clever way that where the gallery itself, you know, trying to raise some money for the museum, was able to participate in new technology, and that the artists were working with the gallery itself, museum shop, to, you know, make their art available and make it more democratic. So, yeah, I think it's really interesting to see how artists are working digitally, and I definitely think that it's a Pandora's box in many ways. You know, I think as the cliche goes, I mean, we're in the wild west of the internet right now. And I think that artists are utilizing it in really great, interesting ways. There was an artist I worked with who created several different profiles for herself on Facebook. And the whole project was called Born Nowhere. And she basically kind of did a Cindy Sherman-esque project for Facebook, where she styled herself in Photoshop and turned herself into all these different identities. And then she asked people to comment on who they thought she was. And so it was an interactive performance in a way, utilizing the digital medium and social platform. So there are ways in which artists are, you know, making cool, interesting things. And some of those things have to be represented in a museum or gallery spaces, like documentation. Some of them are, you know, interactive in a live situation. Like, you know, I've seen kind of interactive Twitter feeds in the museum gallery where people can tweet to, you know, the museum and interface that way. So I think it remains to be seen, and it's just another tool. It's just like, you know, oil paint, and it's a canvas, so it's exciting. It's really exciting.
Okay. All right. I think that's kind of it. If you have any more questions, there were some questions.
You sort of touched on it, but I guess maybe it's a good last question too, is what are some of the concrete things you think artists, galleries, museums can be doing, knowing the current landscape, as you all very brilliantly outlined?
I would say like really quickly, be radically inclusive of multiple state expressions, so that, you know, there's a place for self-taught, a place for all types of expression to live under the same roof, and to create spaces of dialogue that are relevant to artists. I love the, you know, responses that museums are, and spaces museums are creating. Like after Trump was elected, you know, I think that Nina Simon at the Santa Cruz Museum of Art, you know, she opened her doors and said, here's a safe space for artists to come and talk. I think that that is crucial because it really opens up a space of dialogue for collective action and solidarity. I mean, you know, maybe I'm being too political here, I don't know, but I think that it's really important for people to protect spaces of free speech, and that's where artists need to go, to network, so.
I would add in things like be actually receptive to people's communication. I mean, like one of the hardest things to do for an artist is actually get in touch with somebody at a space or at a gallery, somebody that can you know, that you know, even you know, like that gallery, for example, that you've been looking at for a long time, would probably like the work that you do, but how do you get in touch with them? Like how do you establish a line of communication? Short of, but yeah, you're gonna go to those openings, you're gonna try to get in touch with them that way, and you know, ideally maybe you have somebody that is gonna introduce you, but really, I think that there's so much communication that just gets cut off because of the way that the system is set up with, you know, basically every email that's there, there's like info@somethinggallery.com, and then there are things like, you know, no unsolicited submissions, blah blah blah. Everything is distant, you know. There's this it's almost like a cloud, like there's like a daunting cloud that's hanging over the horizon, and you just go, well, how do I, you know, with me being here, how do I establish that connection, you know, unless I know that artist, unless I know that director. So you're constantly in this cycle of, you know, having to, you know, go to, like, putting yourself out there, like going to these places and like trying to establish a circle of friends and collectors and so on until you get to the place that you probably should have been a long time ago. And so I think like opening up communication between places. Yes.
I was gonna say that idea of, you know, when we go back to the precariat, precariat is all about just being valued less than some other member of society that is apparently valued more. And so that in that context of hierarchy, then we need a politics of care. We need institutions to actually value people the same and to create more of a supportive network of care, which I think will mobilize people to help each other, mm-hmm. as opposed to continuing this approach that, you know, it's a dog eat dog world out there,
right.
You know, you gotta crack a few eggs to make an omelet or whatever people say.
Which is strange because I think typically artists aren't of that frame of mind. You know, most artists that I know are like, yeah, like they're totally forward and helpful, and they, you know, they're all about inclusivity. But when it comes down to actually being on the stage with everybody else, then it is the dog eat dog. You know, it's like, why is this artist getting the show and I'm not? Why is this artist selling this painting and I'm not?
And I think that the answer is, you know, to say, well, why do I want the show, and is that my measure of success?
Right, exactly. And I think that's you're hitting something. Like, you know, there's, you know, maybe in the niche markets that we have now, like, you know, maybe it's just about finding that niche market that, you know, you know that your work is about something like, and then somebody out there is going to like it. How do you get it to that person?
And maybe we don't all need to move to New York City to
right.
be famous.
Or LA.
We can just.
Which is why I thought it was interesting to talk about Cincinnati, but, mm-hmm. you know, because I thought Cincinnati was a really interesting city too.
I think Santa Barbara, I've thought this ever since I moved here, 11 years ago. I think it should become a field of dreams in terms of the contemporary art scene. And I think that. I've felt this for a long time, that if we could bring people here, there are artists who have houses with guest rooms in them,
yeah.
bring curators here, choose a certain group of people for those people to go and see in their studios.
Mm-hmm. And establish residencies and things like that, yeah.
I mean, just let them come and see, because there's really amazing work that's being done here. It's not just, you know, the tourists' work. And beautiful paintings, the Oak Group does beautiful paintings, and that's what this area is known for. But there are a lot of really dynamic contemporary artists here who are really not recognized. They may be recognized in a show here and there, but Santa Barbara's not recognized as a hotbed for contemporary art, and it could be, but I think it's a field of dreams idea, and I think it's up to us to create it.
Yeah, we need to borrow, you know, on the shared economy and create spaces for people.
I mean, it could be like, you know, Airbnb. For curators to come. There could be designated places where curators could come and to really experience what's going on here.
I wanted to add that, you know, having lived in a number of different big cities, I was struck by how nurturing the community of curators was here and immediately embraced me. So that's, I mean, you want to think artists are competitive, curators. And so it's been really refreshing to come here and to be embraced, you know, by MCA, by UCSB, and so I will say that that's definitely the beauty of a smaller town, is that we are in this together and we need each other and we need to create that sense of reciprocity in the art world. And I definitely think that, I always say to artists, be your own museum. You know, really approach your artwork as though you're the person doing every part of it. Like, you're archiving it, you're promoting it, you're talking about it, you're making it, and you're conserving it. Those are all, and then also the whole idea of don't wait to be plucked from obscurity. Do it yourself. Make your own shows, curate your own shows, curate your friends into shows, and pay it forward. Because that's really the way that it has to work. There just aren't enough spaces to give everybody their own solo show, and that's really how I've survived in the art world.
Well, thank you.
Good. Yeah, what is your best? Good. Hi.